What's up, everybody? Welcome to episode 196 of the Nerd Cave Podcast. I'm one of your hosts, Derek Diamond, joined along with, as always,
Zach Dykes
and Robbie Rawls.
Guys, before we get started, today's podcast is brought to you by our friends over at audible.com. Get a free audiobook download and 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/nerdcave. And they have a ton of books to choose from for your iPhone, Kindle, Android, or your MP3 player. They have over 180,000 books.
That's a lot of books.
That's like three lifetimes worth of books.
Yeah.
I recently subscribed to Audible, just finished listening to Chris Jericho's autobiography, and now I am listening to Star Wars Bloodline.
Ooh, Bloodline. Really good book.
Is it?
I enjoyed it a lot.
Yeah, I'm really excited for it. Like, it's a lot different than an autobiography, but it's
good. Very twisty. Yeah, Now, I will let you know, once you get into Star Wars books,
you're going to be hooked.
It's a drug. It'll pull you in, son.
They are the most, like, produced. Like, they've got all the sound effects in them. Like,
once that kind of threw me off guard a little bit at first.
Yeah, and, like, they're all voiced and all of that. Like, the person doing them does all the different voices. And then when you go to someone else's book,
You're just like,
this is not a Star Wars book.
It's like with Jericho's book, it was just a guy reading. But then with Star Wars, like when it started, they played the music.
Yeah.
And I was sitting next to Sarah when I was listening to it, and I'm like, she's like, what are you doing? I was like, listen. And she's like,
I love reading Star Wars books, especially through Audible.
Yeah, so they're a lot of fun. So again, go to audibletrial.com/nerdcave for your free audiobook and 30-day free trial.
Free.
And with that being said, how are you guys doing?
I was going to say lackluster, but I'm Zach Dyke, so I can't be lackluster. I'm doing okay.
You're me.
Yeah, it's just been a long, like yesterday was a long day. So, but I'm here. We're doing this thing.
We're doing things.
Yeah.
This table.
That's weird. I'm not doing the table.
It's going to be a very weird show, but you know what? That's okay.
And that's okay.
We're in that state of mind.
Yeah.
You know, we might answer the question, what flavor Robbie tastes like by the end of this? Of ice cream.
Just like, yeah. Be more specific.
How are you, Robbie? Answer the question, go.
I am doing well. A little bit tired. I didn't get a lot of sleep last night.
The Tinkle Fairy came.
Tinkle Fairy did come. I think I talked about it a little bit on the last podcast. I went and had a doctor's appointment this past week, and he gave me my blood pressure medicine because mine's dangerously high. And
all that
turns
fried
out,
chicken.
It is. I love it. But my blood pressure medicine is also a fluid pill. My doctor forgot to tell me that this is a fluid pill. So about 9:30, I took it before I went to bed. From 9:30 till about 8 o'clock in the morning, I peed 7 different times.
Man, you must feel really good, though.
Oh, I mean,
you've got all the toxins out of your body. Yeah,
I've honestly,
you
look
radiant.
It does
like you're
feel
pregnant
really
or something.
You have zero chance of having a kidney stone.
That is so nice. I've had UTIs, and those are bad. I can only imagine.
I remember those days.
I remember that story on this very podcast many moons ago.
I had one, and we were at the youth room, and I went to go use the bathroom, and everybody stopped what they were doing to listen to me urinate in agony.
Just through the door, we could hear.
Worst things with those, especially kidney stones, is when you wake up in the morning and you forget you have them, and you go full blast, and you just go. If that doesn't wake you up, nothing will.
I'm not, like, there was something there. I'm going to let it pass. We'll let it pass.
Just like a kidney stone.
Yes.
So,
Derek, how are you doing?
I can't even top that story. But no, I'm doing good. Another busy week at work. Did a couple of fun interviews this week for my show. Got to interview Ming Chen from Comic Book Men and Bob Bergen, who is a voice actor and also the voice of Porky Pig on Looney Tunes. So both those guys will be at Pensacon in a couple of weeks. So I'll be releasing those. I'll be releasing one on Thursday. I'm actually releasing two episodes this week. Tuesday's is going to be the Arrowverse Roundtable, which I'm curious to get your thoughts, especially.
Hey, I'm catching up. Thank you very much. I watched the crossover the other night.
Oh, do you got through the Flashes and the and Earth
and Legends of Tomorrow?
Okay, did you get to the Civil War episode?
I've only watched. I literally just told you what I did.
Oh, you only watched.
I watched all three of those.
Okay, so you haven't watched like the second any other episode of
Legends. No, I'm not going to watch that show.
You need to.
Jesus Christ, people, stop trying to tell me to watch other things. I'm getting through Arrow and Flash, and then I will do other things.
You are 100% right. Please, trudge through them.
But anyway, that comes out Tuesday. Bob Bergen interview comes out on Thursday. So you get two episodes this week.
Nice. Excited.
Yeah.
And last week you had JDF, Jason mm-hmm. David Frank, on,
mm-hmm.
and you were all Go-Go Power Ranger.
It blew up. Like, it's still getting downloads, isn't it?
It's it passed the 3,000 mark the other day. So it was crazy.
Yeah.
Very, very, very happy.
Oh, thank
very
you.
Very pleased.
Thank
you. Not about that.
What?
Jeez, conceited much?
Because I'm happy.
But yeah, very, very excited doing work here.
Work.
I knew it would happen. So, y'all ready to move into
after that,
the news of the week?
After that, absolutely.
Everybody's like, why are they're talking about pee. Next week they'll talk about
poop.
We've
lost half our audience already.
Within the first 10 minutes of the show.
You're welcome.
They'll start talking about poop next week. All right, moving into the news. If you don't know, before we move into the news, every week we put out this show, the Nerd Cave Podcast. You want it early? You go to patreon.com/nerdcave. You can get it early. There. There it is, right there. If you don't want to pay and you want to wait, or you want to get it segment by segment. Last week was so much better when I said this. It was like perfect. Segment by segment, day by day. You can go over to youtube.com/nerdcavenetwork and check it out there, or over on our Facebook page, facebook.com/nerdcavenetwork. You can check that out there, or you can wait till Friday where it comes out on YouTube and podcast services around the world.
Around the world.
All right. That being said, let's move into our first article of the week. Lando Calrissian, Billy Dee Williams on meeting Donald Glover. I almost said Danny Glover. the Han Solo movie, and I said Han because that's how Billy Dee says it. The original Lando Calrissian, Billy Dee Williams, has shared his thoughts on meeting Donald Glover for the upcoming standalone Han Solo movie. As spotted by a fan on Twitter, Williams and Glover were having lunch together while discussing where to take Lando next and how different Glover's take on the character from Williams' iconic portrayal. So you can see the picture back there. You can see him in the corner.
Yeah.
Old Billy back there just looking at a menu, and Donald Glover just looking out the window like, is this old man? Why is this old man here? I don't know him.
I wonder what he's drinking. If it's if it's special beverage that he promotes.
You mean the cold malt liquor? Cold
looks like malt. A mimosa. I don't even know what a mimosa looks like. While doing an interview with the Hollywood Reporter, Williams explained that Glover simply just wanted to meet and get to know him and figure out the best way to use Williams' performance in developing this different, younger Lando. Glover has his own ideas for the character, and William believes that Glover's eccentric personality is key to his performance as the beloved smuggler. He is particularly eclectic in the way he approaches his art, Williams said. When I talked to him, I really got the sense that being a worldly person. Lando goes on to say, never thought of anybody else being Lando, and he's not ready to say goodbye to him just yet. So originally, Billy Dee was like, no, like the Steve Carell on The Office. That was him when they
were, God, no!
But he's kind of changed his mind now. That's that he good. Sees who's playing him, seeing where it's going. He goes on to say, but I'm not saying goodbye to the character. It's still very much a part of my life. I created that character, and you can't take him away from me. So what are y'all thoughts on that?
I like it. I like it a lot because it shows that he's really wanting to get into the character. He's wanting to learn where this character has been so he can kind of mirror it because, you know, this is a younger version
of
him.
Would he be a mirror master?
Maybe.
I like how he's making these jokes that we've been wanting to make, and he finally gets to make them.
Mirror Master's been a freaking Flash villain for years.
I know, but it's only become super relevant in the shows. But it's cool.
Whatever.
I'm just giving you a hard time. But I like it because he's like, all right, this is where Lando is. And, you know, Glover wants to kind of put his own spin on it, but kind of take it in a similar route. So, I mean, I like it.
No, I agree with everything you said. I think, if anything, it shows respect for the role that he is meeting with the person who made it famous. And kind of taking what Billy Dee did in Empire and Jedi, but also adding his twist on it. Because he's a younger Lando, so there's obviously going to be some differences between the two versions.
I want him to be super cocky.
I'm sure he will be.
And I also think, with that line you said about Billy Dee not wanting to let go of the character just yet, I think he's going to have a cameo in Episode 8.
Yeah, they asked about it, and he said that he'd be up for it, but they haven't asked him yet.
So I think he's in it.
I was about to say, I think actors and actresses say that, but they're like, oh, I'm really in it, but I'm just not going to tell you. Thanks, Alexa.
She doesn't like you.
I don't like you either.
And you know what I don't like? This whole Ben Affleck bull crap.
I know.
It just won't die.
Derek Daniel asks, thoughts on Ben Affleck stepping down as director of Batman movie? Is this a result of everyone asking him about the movie, or do you think he got in over his head? So, I'm going to read an article. After we discuss it, we're going to talk about why we think Ben Affleck stepped down. What are your thoughts on that? I think he's being a pansy, but
I think he needs to put his big boy pants on and direct the freaking movie, because that's what had me so excited about this movie, was that Ben Affleck was over it. And, you know, because I trust his genius. He knows the character. I mean, we've already seen him as this character, and we loved him as it. And I've heard rumors that saying that, could this also mean that he will no longer be Batman either?
And that's unfounded.
No, that's dumb.
Stop being stupid, people.
Yeah. I mean, I think he might have gotten in over his head, and I think a lot of getting hounded, you know, left and right about the movie, you know, about, you know, creative differences and stuff like that, and people bringing it up and up and up and up and up and up.
He signed on for that. That's what happens. Yeah. It's a big thing. Like, any Batman movie is a big, big movie. So
anytime you're in a movie, if you're a director of a movie, guess what? You're going to get asked questions a lot.
Derek never got asked questions, so that's not true.
Why are we doing this, Derek? Why are you making us do this? He got them all the time.
Well, I'm saying I'm saying from the press. So, Derek, what are your thoughts on
that? Well, the way you phrased it was a lot nicer than what was asked, but that's okay. I think, not to sound like a cop-out, but I honestly don't know. I mean, it could be him caving under the pressure. His statement was that he wanted to dedicate 100% of his time and effort to playing the character and not have to worry about the director aspect of it, which I can get it, because this movie is going to have a lot of pressure behind it. Because as device as the opinion has been of the DC movie so far, everyone can agree that, you know, the Nolan Batman movies were amazing. Yeah. So expectations are going to be extremely high for this. So maybe he has someone in mind that he would like to work with. I know Zack Snyder is a rumored person. I don't think that should happen.
Tim Burton.
That either. But I don't know. If he's doing it for that reason, I can understand it.
I just want a Batman movie. Like, I want a good Batman movie, and if he doesn't think he can do both the jobs, then let him focus on being Batman and stop, like, oh, he's not going to be Batman now, so we're going to have to recast Batman.
Shia LaBeouf.
John Hamm. As Batman. If that happens, John Hamm, like I said, freaking 3 years ago.
Shia LaBeouf.
Shut up. I will murder you with this microphone. Shia LaBeouf. He's a cannibal.
Hey, he stopped Decepticons in 3 different movies.
Blah, blah, blah. We'll get to that one in a minute. Now, Derek, you hit on this point about who's going to direct it. The Batman. These directors are rumored to be on the short list to replace Affleck. Matt Reeves, George Miller, and several others in contention. As one of the brothers continues its search for a director to helm the Batman following Ben Affleck's departure, a list of directors rumored to be in contention to helm the DC movies have surfaced. According to Forbes, several names are floating around already, with a short list of contenders that includes George Miller, which made Mad Max, Matt Reeves, which did Cloverfield, Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, Gavin O'Connor, Warrior and the Accountant, and Dennis.
I hope he directs it.
Prisoners and Arrival, and Matt Ross, Captain Fantastic, are all on the list. So, who's your... You want Dennis, whatever his name is.
If George Miller did it, that would be awesome.
You know he was going to do a Justice League movie.
Oh, long time ago.
I cannot talk today, guys. I'm sorry. I've tried my hardest.
Because George Miller is a beast.
Oh, yeah.
The man was in his 60s, and he spent over a year making Mad Max, which is visually one of the best movies I've ever seen, period.
Oh, yeah.
And he's still got the passion for it. He's still got his... You know, he's a very talented director. Out of those choices, I would say him. And it's not even a competition to me.
Yeah, I agree. I want George Miller over it.
George Miller's the obvious first choice, but the guy who made the Accountant and all that stuff, I think it was the second one you said, Dennis. Was it Dennis?
He made Arrival.
Oh, I can't remember. But George
Miller. Did you close out that one? Hold on just a second.
It's okay. It's okay. We can move on.
It'll be okay. We'll deal with it.
It was one of those other ones.
It was a guy that did stuff that directed
but
this.
But we all know George Miller is the fan favorite.
Yes.
I want Frank Miller.
Sure, why not?
But
that'll be very interesting. It would probably be terrible, but I would go see it.
But by the end of it, like the art style will change and it'd just be really crazy.
Gavin O'Connor.
Oh, Gavin O'Connor.
The final fight is Shalali. A bunch of stick figures fighting each other.
Like, sorry guys, Frank just got tired.
Yeah. He just said screw it.
Now, one article that I read that was quite interesting, and one of the directors that everyone was like, he's going to do it, he's going to do it, he's done Flash, he's done Supergirl, was Kevin Smith, and Kevin was just like, ha, 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 that's funny, no. But Kevin and his co-host of Fat Man on Batman,
Mark Bernardin,
were talking about this idea. Kevin Smith thinks Batman should go the Star Wars route. While sharing his thoughts on Ben Affleck's reasons for dropping out as director, as well as his... as who he thinks should replace him on the Batman film, Kevin Smith revealed he thinks Warner Brothers should go the Star Wars route with the character. While the topic began with Fat Man on Batman co-host Mark Bernardin suggesting a noir kung fu mashup with a minimal budget starring the Cape Crusader, Smith took that thought one step further and suggested different annual installments. Get on that schedule, Smith said, and throw him around to everybody. Just make a bunch. Make the Kung Fu one. Make the ridiculously expensive one. Make one in space. Make Justice League Dark. Every year, there needs to be a Batman movie. Smith said in the publishing line, he's not put in a special box. Bernardin added, the character has enough villains to sustain that schedule. You don't get to the bottom of the barrel until you are 9 movies in before you're like, Calendar Man? Sure. So, do y'all think that could be a way to take Batman, doing him annually?
Is it possible? Yes. Would it make money? Yes. Will they do it? No.
No, they wouldn't. They won't.
They wouldn't, but I would be 100% down with it because, you know, even though we crap on the older Batmans, I enjoy watching Batman no matter what it's in. If it's Tim Burton that directed it or Nolan that directed it, I enjoy watching Batman.
I don't mind Tim Burton. It's Joel Schumacher that I mind.
Oh, yeah. Schumacher. Oh, Shoe.
No.
I still say
that. Do not sully Shuhei's name. I will murder you with this microphone. That's the second reference to murdering you today. Just want everyone to know if he goes dead is by my hands.
Today's episode titled Murder and Urine.
That's a headline if I've ever seen one. But, you know, I wish they would do it like Star Wars where we have one each year because, I mean, out of anybody, his the villains in Batman in the comics are just so many great ones, and you could have multiple movies on just the Joker.
Think of the stories you could adapt. We could finally get that live-action Heart of Ice movie.
Oh, yeah. Hush.
Yes.
Hush would be amazing.
You got.
You get all, like, you do, like, a bunch of, like, solo films with all the different villains, and then you do Hush.
Court of Owls.
Because that uses all the villains, but it works.
Yeah. Court of Owls would be awesome. You know, Death of the Family would be cool. There's so many Batman storylines that could be done, and original ones as well. But I think adapting some of the more iconic stories would be great. And if that happened, that'd be awesome. Do you think Ben Affleck would stay on as the only Batman, or would you have to cast a Batman for each film?
That's a lot of time to dedicate. I mean, I would like him to.
And, I mean, he would make a lot of money. But how many times do you see a actor want to reprise the same role where he doesn't have...
So,
yeah.
But he wasn't in a movie every single year.
It felt like it.
Yeah. You end that run with Dark Knight Returns.
Ooh. And you get John Hamm to do it. Not Batfleck. John Hamm.
Just bring him in for Dark Knight Returns.
Or you get Peter Wells.
Yeah. I can only imagine your reaction in the theater. Oh, my God.
Sanctuary! Sanctuary!
Oh, God.
Ah, I love it.
You would get thrown out.
I would get thrown out. I couldn't watch the movie in public.
We have to have a special screening just for Sam.
Yes, yes. Moving on. I hope that answers your question, Derek. Aquaman cast Jango Fett, actor Tamora Morrison as DC Hero's human father. Star Wars actor Tamora Morrison, who played Jango Fett in the prequel films, is currently in negotiation to join the cast of Aquaman. According to Hollywood Reporter, Morrison, also known for his role as Abin Sur, which I did not know that until reading this, in the Green Lantern movie, is in talks to star as Aquaman's human father. Morrison isn't the only actor in talks of joint cast. As earlier this week, Nicole Kidman was reportedly offered the role as Aquaman's mother. So we'll jump over to that one with Nicole Kidman, and we'll read a little bit about it. Load, you thing. There we go. So Nicole Kidman, according to the Hollywood Reporter, has been Juan's top choice for this week for weeks. That would be weird. You're my top choice this week. Next week, it will be different. With an official offer finally going out Monday. In the DC Comics, Aquaman's mom, Atlanta. Seriously? That's her name? Atlanta?
She's named after the city?
Atlanta? Jeez.
Oh, is her last name Georgia?
Like Atlanta's Atlanta? Why, comic book writers? Jeez.
I think it's clever.
Was a member of the Atlantean royal family who fell in love with a lighthouse keeper, Tom Curry. Not Tim Curry. Tom Curry. And Tissa. Patient. And gave birth to their half-human, half-Atlantean son, Arthur Curry. Man, this show is so bad today.
That's all good.
Oh, I love it. If she does sign on the Aquaman, then Aquaman wouldn't be Kidman's first DC movie, having also starred in the 1995's Batman Forever as Dr. Chase Meridian. She was also up for the role of Wonder Woman's mother, Queen Hippolyta, Chipotle, a part that went to Connie Nielsen.
We're going to lose so many subscribers.
Or gain a lot.
I think this is the most fun I've had in a while.
I did get to do a Tim Curry laugh on the podcast, so my day's already made.
I'll say if Nicole Kidman is not reprising her role as Dr. Chase Meridian, I have zero interest. But in all seriousness, she's a really good actress.
I haven't seen her act
in anything in years.
Yeah. What was that last movie she was in? The Golden Compass?
Yeah, I want to
say. That's the last one I remember seeing her.
I remember her being in, like, it was like she was this woman in the wilderness, and like it was cowboys and snow, and he's fixing to turn Super Saiyan.
No.
It's not Brokeback Mountain. I know that.
No.
Now you have to add Super Saiyan hair to him.
I'm not doing that.
Oh, man. It was like not.
What was it about?
It was about her in the snow. It's probably like earlier 2000s. Like 2007, 2000.
There were Indians in it.
Yes, there were Indians in it. I remember that. And like they were attacking.
I have no idea what you guys are talking about.
It was like
about.
During the Civil War.
I know.
It was like right after the Civil War. Allie's looking it up. No, it went 9. Well, while she looks that up, we've got a thesis.
While you're reading that, I will also.
Derek Daniel, you're killing me, Smalls. You are killing me. Thoughts on the CW getting a fifth superhero show in Black Lightning? It was supposed to be originally on Fox, as they've even ordered it to be a pilot, but now Fox has backed out, saying they have too many comic properties as it is. Even though they have Gotham and Lucifer and will be adding the new X-Men live-action show, but... yeah, they have too many right now. I understand Greg Berlanti's thought process as he wanted to see what one of his shows can do on a bigger network, as they already had season one of Supergirl on CBS. Granted, CBS handled it poorly, but I digress. But this is the second time that one of Berlanti's ideas has turned away by Fox, with other being the Archer comic properties Riverdale, which just recently started.
I haven't watched that show yet. I really want to, though.
I haven't either. I've seen that. I've heard that it's good.
Cold Mountain?
Cold Mountain.
Oh, yeah. yeah, you're right.
There you go, guys. Cold Mountain. No, that's in Australia.
That's the one with the greatest American actor of all time.
Nicole Kidman?
No, Hugh
Jeff Goldblum.
Oh. back to the
anyway,
question.
So... he's basically asking if we think Black Lightning is, or they're adding too many heroes to that universe.
Do you think he should still try to put his shows on bigger networks, or should he stay where his bread and butter is? Nope, I'm changing it. On CW, has he practically taken over the network anyway?
He can't keep, they can't keep putting out.
They can do whatever they want.
I'm sure they can. But
they're going to start adding days to the week so they can put more shows out.
This is CW day. Like, this is where nothing but like the superhero. But no, like, I mean, you got the 100, iZombie, Supernatural, you know, a ton of these shows that are on the CW. And he's going to have to start marketing to other networks because they can't, they've already been moving around stuff to fit Supergirl, The Flash, Legends, Arrow. And, you know, you can't keep adding onto it.
Well, a spot is opening up on CW because Vampire Diaries is ending after this season. So,
thank you. I never started it.
I did.
Yeah, I did too.
Those were dark days.
Oh, me too. but anyway. Yeah, eventually it is going to be too much. I mean, if it doesn't work, you just cancel the show.
You just got to... sprinkle it in a little bit.
Please don't ever do that again.
I actually did that on my chicken the other night. I was like seeing if it really worked, and I was like, oh.
How about you cast me outside?
How about that? Yeah, she's coming back on Dr. Phil.
God,
it's gonna be awesome.
God. This is what our lives have turned into. Meme after meme. And it's not even like clever memes anymore. It's not like, you know, insert clever meme here, like whatever your favorite is. It's not that. It's stupid people.
Yeah, at first I had no idea what those memes were because I didn't see the clip.
And like, I saw the clip like 2 years ago.
Yeah. Like,
oh, it's been that long?
Yeah.
I thought this was like recent.
And they just now were like, cash me outside.
How about that?
It's so dumb. I hear so many people... say it. I can play on Xbox Live, and as soon as I hear a team member say, cash me outside, mute. I don't care if we lose.
I don't think it's around here, but I saw a picture of a church sign that said, cash God inside, how about death? Yeah, I'm not lying.
Now, I do find it hilarious when pastors have a sense of humor.
I do too, but geez.
But you got to be careful.
No, it's...
But anyway, why not add another show?
Why not?
Like I said, if it doesn't work, you have the character be recurring on like Flash or Legends.
Allie's pulling up the picture of...
Yep, that's it.
Britt David Baptist Church, Cash God Inside. How about that?
Baptist.
Trying to be hip. As bad as his Methodist.
Today's episode, Murder and Urine. How about that?
I'm actually good.
This is like the most fun I've had.
I mean, we're completely off the rails. Yeah. We're teetering off of them.
Earlier I said, if you're a Power Rangers fan, you need to go jump out a window.
Why would you say that?
Because it's morphin' time. You can't morph inside a house.
Yeah, that's true.
They do it inside the command center all the time.
That's not a house.
It's Zordon.
It's the command center.
Alfalfa's house. I mean, they don't go.
Alfalfa. Power Rangers. Final postal. Oh, Jesus. Final poster for the movie has been released.
What are we doing?
It's morphin' time as the movie arrives March 24th, which...
Right around the corner.
Over 2 months away. The poster, which debuted on Twitter, shows the Rangers leaping into action with the Zords. It's much better to look at the robotic companions compared to the Power Rangers print released in December.
I like the poster.
I do too.
Some of the Zords look very different. Like, that doesn't look like a
saber tooth.
It looks like a duck bill, like...
It's a platypus tiger.
Yeah, platypus tiger. The Power Rangers will have more than their Zords and Megazord to help them. They obviously will have the guidance of Zordon, too. They left Alpha 5 out on that. You bastards!
But they're going to be able to make the purest of... I'm not going to go there.
Meth?
Meth.
Did y'all see the Saturday Night Live?
With Cranston?
Yeah, like
I didn't.
they were joking that Cranston was appointed head of the DEA as Walter White. They were like, in a weird turn, a chemistry teacher, high school chemistry teacher, has been appointed head of the DEA. We have him here tonight. He's like, we're gonna have a lot of red, a lot of white. And a whole lot of blue.
United States of America, you are the danger.
He was like, there have been a lot of people knocking on his doors. And he's like, I'm the one who knocks. So it was really good. You need to check it out. Yeah. Like, that was a funny little, it was like a little bitty skit, but really, really funny. Now, another thing that brightens my day, just makes my heart smile. Michael Bay announces The Last Night is his final Transformers movie.
I'll believe it when they make the sixth movie without him.
I hope they don't make a sixth movie.
Well, there's that, too.
And then just kill everything.
Because didn't he say that the third one was going to be his last? And then the fourth one. And but now he's doing a fifth one.
That was a plot twist.
What a twist.
A very twisty episode.
Director, producer... If everyone gets that reference. Michael Bay has announced that Transformers The Last Night will be his last Transformers movie. After being involved with the Transformers franchise for over a decade now, Bay has decided to call it quits, and this time, for good. The director didn't list a specific reason for his departure from the series. It's bittersweet for me. With every Transformer film, I've said it would be my last, Bay wrote on the site. I've seen the 120 million fans around the world... who see these movies, the huge theme park lines, the ride and amazing Make-A-Wish kids who visit my sets, and somehow keeps me drawing me back.
Drunk.
Keeps me drunk.
I love doing these movies. These films was especially fun. This film. Go home, Michael Bay. It's going to be huge.
Huge.
Especially fun to shoot, but this time might really be it. Might.
There's your loophole, Michael Bay, you little lying sack of poop.
He's able to sink it in there.
So I'm blowing this one out. He's talking about that line of cocaine. He's like, oh, I got to better stop not getting all of that. So there you go. What are your thoughts? Good riddance?
Indifferent, because I probably won't see the last night.
I won't either.
I got some come up to me. He's like, hey, man, you excited for the new Transformers? I'm like, no.
Did they sound exactly like that?
Yeah, that's exactly how I pictured
What's it, the pimp?
Oh, slick.
I was like, no, not at all. He's like, man, I like Mark Wahlberg way better than... I was like, no.
It's the Transformer.
Shia LaBeouf was the greatest Decepticon killer of all time.
He didn't actually kill a Decepticon.
He shot at one.
A lot of people shot at him.
He helped.
So
actually, he did kill one because he stuck the Allspark in the chest of Megatron.
Yeah, but Megatron came back, so he didn't technically kill him.
I mean, technicalities.
That's what life runs on.
My thoughts are, sure.
Don't let the door hit you or the good Lord split you.
On to better
onward
things.
And upwards.
Is this picture the season 2 premiere date of Stranger Things season 2?
Dang, it's cold.
Stranger Things Twitter account dropped a cryptic tweet that seems to have revealed when season 2 will premiere. The pinned tweet includes just an image of a Houston weather report promising some major thunderstorms on Sunday. That tweet coincided with Entertainment Weekly announcing Netflix will run a Stranger Things TV spot during Super Bowl 51, also on Sunday. And you can see that down there below. If you scroll a little bit further, you get to see the Entertainment Weekly picture. Have both of y'all seen that?
The Ghostbusters.
Yep.
Where they're in the Ghostbuster outfits. That's freaking awesome.
Yeah. What I love about this show so much is the simple nods to other things in pop culture.
Well, it's not really simple, but
I mean that's more than simple. But in the first season it was more simple. But you know, that's one thing I guess that hooked me in to this was, you know, the nods, like, you know, E.T. and everything like that. It was just that kid. He's my favorite. He's my favorite. I don't know about y'all, but
yeah, he's up there.
Well, you can see what Zach did with the picture. He's like zooming it in and out. He's like,
the audio version is like, what the crap is going on here?
Oh, this week's episode. Murder and urine. How about that? But in all seriousness, I can't wait for Stranger Things season 2. It was my favorite show of 2016. Like you said, it's the fact that it's also set in the 80s allows it to really have that feel. And it's also an original concept.
Mm-hmm.
How about that?
It's nice, you know, being born in the 80s and you get to remember and relive all that stuff that you lived the 6 months that you were born in the 80s.
I was born a real decade, the 90s.
89.
It was a real decade.
Derek, you were born in the 70s. Get over yourself.
Derek was born in like the 1870s.
I love you.
All right, Robbie.
I love you.
Robbie's like the villain of the show.
I should have came in with my mustache curled up.
Your mustache. Your mustache.
I was about to say Miss Pettis, but Miss Wilkes was like, yeah, it doesn't work with the whole beard. It needs to be just the mustache.
You know, it helps when you're talking on a microphone.
I was like, what is this? carry on.
Speaking of villains, Hercules, Kevin Sorbo joins Supergirl as a new villain.
Hercules
actor Kevin Sorbo has joined the cast of Supergirl. Sorbo, best known for his role as title character in Hercules, The Legendary Journeys, will have a recurring role in the CW series, where he'll play the mysterious new villain. In addition to his iconic role as Hercules. Sorbo played Captain Dylan Hunt in the TV series Andromeda.
Should be a voiceover guy for TV commercials.
Since his days as Hercules, Kevin Sorbo has brought such a strong presence to the screen, and we couldn't be more excited to have him join us on Supergirl. Hercules. So what do you think about Sorbo being on?
I think it's cool. I always enjoyed Hercules back in the day. Eventually this episode title is going to be too long for me to keep the thing going, but I mean, I think it's cool.
Now, I did always enjoy him in Hercules, but he's been in different shows like Hawaii.
He was in God of War.
He was in God. I mean, everything.
He was in God of War 3.
Was he?
Yes, he played Hercules in God of War 3.
Hercules! Sorry.
You got to commit to the bit, bro.
I was blown away by him being in. But anyway, he's a great actor, and I'm sure he'll do great on Supergirl, which I know none of y'all will watch, but I'll see him in Supergirl because I watch it.
Yeah, I watch things that are good.
So do I. Second
that
season.
Are
super.
Superman.
Oh. Adam asked before we wrap up this part of the show, what Disney or Pixar movie do you want to have as live action? I read that wrong, but that's okay. Mulan is one and only choice. Maybe very creepy version of Toy Story. So what would y'all want as a live action movie?
I mean, it's already going to happen, but Aladdin.
I'm definitely down for Aladdin, but one that I would really like to see is The Nightmare Before Christmas. I feel like it's always underrated, and I watch it every Halloween and sometimes Christmas because it's one of those great movies that work as both.
Live action Ratatouille would be interesting.
That would.
I love that movie.
I would like to see Street Sharks in a movie.
That's not a Disney.
I know. Yeah. I was just throwing something random out there.
Robbie, you got to stick to the script.
Yeah, man. We've been doing it all episode.
Yeah. We've totally been on the rails this entire episode. So, I mean. Totally.
It has been.
Yeah.
That's the illusion that we're not on the rails. Yeah. Just like Twisty. I skipped over a whole article right here. I don't really have any pick. Mulan's the one that I want, and Aladdin's getting made as well. So
yeah. And Lion King.
Yeah, so I'm all good with that. I don't see how Lion King can necessarily be live action because they're all
means no worries.
Animals. There's no human in it, so it's not really live action.
I mean, it'll probably just be like Jungle Book.
I say they did it with Baloo and Bagheera.
Yeah, but you had a kid in that, so that made it live action.
Whatever.
Last article of the day, Star Wars. Mark Hamill defends Jake Lloyd and the prequels. Broadway version? Oh, that would be cool.
That would be sweet.
Yeah.
Broadway
version.
I like
where you think.
Broadway version of Lion King's amazing. We're going to have to get her a mic so she can chime in when we do something stupid.
I just pick up and throw mine over there.
She will apparently be talking all the time if we have episodes like this. Luke Skywalker star Mark Hamill has come forward to defend George Lucas' much-criticized Star Wars prequel films, as well as young Anakin Skywalker actor Jake Lloyd. I couldn't believe some of the things they wrote about the prequels, Hamill said in an interview with Vulture, adding that he's still angry about the way they treated Jake Lloyd for his performance in Star Wars Episode I, The Phantom Menace. He was only 10 years old, Mark continued, noting that Lloyd did exactly what George Lucas wanted him to do. He acknowledged that the film had clunky dialogue, and while he has issues with George, he still loves that man. The actor went on to call the negative response to the prequel films just brutal. One of these reasons he would never let his kids be in show business. Hamill reprises his role as Luke Skywalker in Star Wars The Last Jedi, a title that he thinks has a samurai vibe to it. What are your thoughts?
I mean, it's not surprising. Hamill seems like... I've never really seen him criticize anything, really. So I think he's, in a way, being politically correct. Now, I believe that he believes what he says.
Yeah.
And just like everyone else, you know, he has the right to his opinion. I do think the prequels maybe do get a little too much flack. They do have their good qualities.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they don't compare to the originals or even the newer ones that have come out. But, you know, I respect his opinion.
Yeah, like, I mean, I know I've been on, talked several times about the first one, my favorite part being just the complete change of lightsaber battles, how it changed it for the entirety of Star Wars starting from the prequels on. You know, that, and, you know, I didn't mind Lloyd as much as everybody else. The older Anakin, the whiny emo Anakin, didn't care for him. But, I mean, Lloyd, for being as young as he was, you know, didn't do a bad job. And, yes, I do agree that there was some clunky dialogue. And
that's Star Wars in a nutshell.
Yeah. Like, I
mean, Cindy Saiwa 5 movie.
But, I mean, I do think, like both of y'all said, I do believe that it gets a little bit too much flack. You know, I go back and I could still enjoy watching them.
You know, you got to give it to him. Jake Lloyd got the queen.
Yeah, and she was like 4 or 5 years older than
yeah.
him.
Yeah, and she's
you
a
go,
pedophile.
Kid. Yeah.
When it comes down to it, pedophilia. So there you have it. There's all the movie news that you need to know.
Someone never watched Star Wars. There's pedophilia in Star Wars. Oh, my God.
Are you God, what is the really pasty comedian? Jim Gaffigan. That's who you sounded like.
I didn't know that. Pedophilia in Star Wars. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
Is there a Peter File around here? My name's Peter File. Oh, so there.
The rails are way over there now.
Mm-hmm.
We're way over here.
I told you today's show was going to be weird.
It is. I'm okay with
but
it.
But I like it, though.
Yeah.
It's good to have.
Oh, yeah.
I'm looking at him. Yeah. I'm giving the subtle hints.
That's your cue, Robbie.
For you, the listeners of the Nerd Cave podcast, Audible is offering a free audiobook. Download with a free 30-day trial to give you the opportunity to check out their service. All you have to do is go to audibletrial.com/nerdcave and get your free book. And even if you only listen for the 30 days.
Keep going.
For the 30 days, guess what? You can still get to keep that book. And there's... What are you doing?
I'm helping you out, man. I'm helping you out. Just
there's over 180,000 books. And as we've all talked about, we have some great ones in the Star Wars universe. Mass Effect, Gears of War, Halo. So you need to check it out.
Ahsoka is really good. Been reading it.
Is it?
I want to read it.
Really good. Continues off like where the end of the Clone Wars happens, like when they ended the series, and takes up from there.
I wonder if it ties into Rebels at all. Because
I'm not sure if it does.
She comes back in the first season of Rebels.
She is rebelling in this book. So
have either of you guys read Catalyst?
No.
I have not read that one. That's one
I've heard mixed things.
Yeah.
So I was curious.
That's
about
one
it.
I read reviews and I'm like, nah,
yeah. We'll wait a little bit.
Yeah.
On that.
So, but you were talking about Bloodlines. Really, really good.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of the alternate reality to what the original, like, extended universe is. Because in the original universe, everybody knew that the family connection. And this
oh, so
one,
no one knows.
No one knows.
Interesting.
Was this the book where things get weird?
No, that's Splinter of the Mind's Eye.
Okay.
Yeah, that's an old book.
Yeah,
Bloodline
that's
is
77.
New. Yeah.
Nope.
Awkward.
Yep. Guys, make sure you go over to audible.com, audibletrial.com/nerdcave. That's audibletrial.com/nerdcave and get your free audiobook and 30-day free trial of Audible.
This is Audible.
I was going to say, like, build it beautiful or something like that, but they don't have a line.
Yeah.
So there you go. Oh, we're only halfway there.
Living on a prayer.
There you go. Setting them up. You're knocking them down. Bow, bow, bow. Derek Daniel, he says, thoughts on Sony's next system update finally letting you add an external hard drive to the system. What size hard drive will you be getting? I'm going to get like a 2 terabyte hard drive for that thing and just crank it up. Just like, yeah, put all the games.
What are the options?
I don't know.
No, we don't know.
They haven't like really. Oh, you can contain up to 8 terabytes of data. So there you go. Yeah.
Interesting.
So now, I'm going to get an 8 terabyte. I don't think they actually make those.
This is, great news to gamers everywhere, because I know I have yet to get one for my Xbox, but I know how annoying it is to when you get a game and you're like, oh, go to your games. You need to delete something so you can make space for another game. And I'm at that point right now where the For Honor beta had an update, and they were like, guess what? You have to delete another game to make room for this update. I'm like, are you kidding me? So I had to get rid of a game, and you know, a lot of these games I still play. I have Destiny on my game list. I don't know why I still have that downloaded, but that might be the next casualty.
Yeah.
But
I have an unopened copy for you.
I appreciate it, man. You can probably sell that copy for like $10 now.
Yeah,
maybe. The updates.
Yeah.
So, well, let's go over what's going to be in the update 4.50. The beta version will be out for the people that have signed up for that on February 3rd, which is 2 days ago. it boasts many new features, including PSVR support for 3D video, external hard drive compatibility, and in lieu of other interface social updates. External hard drive support. While the PS4 and PlayStation 4 Pro owners can currently upgrade their internal hard drives, this update will enable them to use an external hard drive as well. The drive must be a USB 3.0 port and can contain up to 8 terabytes of data. It can hold media files, applications, and games. User save games will still be stored on the internal drive. So everything but your actual saves will stay on the... saves will stay on the internal drive. We'll talk a little bit about PS4 Boost in another article right after this. So PSVR 3D Blu-ray, the update will enable the players who own a PSVR system to watch 3D Blu-rays without a 3D TV, stereoscopic 3D created by using two separate lenses in conjunction with one another, will be used to create an effect normally achieved with 3D glasses. Other updates include there are several additions to the features that contain updates to the cosmetic, social, and functional aspects of the PS4 systems. You'll be able to do custom wallpapers, which is awesome. Players will now be able to use custom screenshots and images as their backgrounds and wallpapers for their consoles, menu screens. Update PSN activity feeds. PSN users will now be able to post their status updates directly to the activity feed, which appears on their friends' What's New tab. Simplified notifications. The updates condense the notifications list into one page as opposed to several lists under various categories. Party access. Players will be able to access party options from the quick menu. While in game, the menu will also be reduced to the size limit, the amount of game screen it takes up.
Now, the one that I like a lot is the custom wallpaper, because I know back on my 360.
Yep, you could do that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I uploaded a picture of whenever we all went to Waimama for a mission trip, and I was able to have a picture of us playing soccer and me look like I'm not knowing anything like what I'm doing, which is true because I'm not good at soccer. And, you know, that was my background for the longest time, and it's really cool to be able to customize it.
Yeah, I agree with that.
So the PS4 boost mode. This one was kind of interesting. Everybody's kind of focused on the hard drive, which is a huge thing. I'm very, very excited about that. But boost mode will let PS4 Pro run at a higher GPU and CPU clock speed for smoother gameplay on some PS4 games that were released before the launch of the PS4 Pro and has not been updated to support the PS4 Pro. Games that have a variable frame rate may benefit from a higher frame rate, and load times may be shorter in games too. So what it's saying is, if you have a Pro and you have games that could run a higher frame rate, but the older PlayStations or the Slim can't do it, then this is going to boost it and make it better and everything. So
that's cool.
I'm glad that they're actually using the system, because right now everything's locked in. It will run the same on every console, except you get HDR support, like full HDR support on the Pro. So I'm glad that they're finally doing something worth doing on this. So that's exciting. There's not an actual release date on 4.5's release date, except for the beta, which started a few days ago. So, yeah. Thoughts on Mass Effect? This is a question from Derek. Thoughts on Mass Effect Andromeda not having an official server? Not having dedicated servers?
I know the third one did, right? I want to say...
Yeah, the third one had dedicated servers to it.
Because, you know, they had the multiplayer, which I enjoyed playing the multiplayer a lot because it tied into the missions and everything like that.
Yeah.
When you get into the area of not having your own server, I feel like it just it works to... too many people get on. And you know, yeah, and that hurts your product. Because, I mean, look at Pokemon Go and all these other things who've had server issues in the past. You know, people weren't able to play, so they're like, all right, peace out, bro.
Yeah, and I think they might have seen data that made this decision. You know, it's not something, oh, we're going to save money by not having dedicated servers. They might have seen from Mass Effect 3, there's not a lot of people playing the multiplayer, so let's not make dedicated servers. Let's just use what we have in-house, and let's host them there. And they probably saw it from Dragon Age as well, that there wasn't a lot of people actually playing on the servers, the multiplayer part of it. And if it's going to help them, you know, focus elsewhere,
yeah,
it's fine by me.
Yeah.
But it is, if they're wanting the multiplayer part of it to actually be something bigger, something, you know, really involved, then they definitely need to have those servers. And they might see, hey, we do need dedicated servers, and then get them going.
Yeah, I'm all for, you know, as long as they would correct the mistake if it's not enough. Because, yeah, you know, I know in Dragon Age, because I still enjoy playing the online part of it.
Yeah.
So I would get on there and I'm trying to find a party and it just takes forever to find somebody to play with unless you're playing on like the super, super hard difficulties, which I die in like 3 seconds. You know, if as long as they would fix it, if it's an issue, then I'm cool with them housing it themselves.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
I jumped right into questions without doing the whole rigmarole into questions.
That's all good.
But we've been sprinkling questions everywhere.
Yeah.
Guys, each and every week, we go over to facebook.com/groups/nerdcavenetwork.
Oh, my God.
Robbie is dying in front of your eyes. I didn't kill him. See, my hands are up here.
It's the cramp you get when you yawn sometimes. Just carry on.
Yep. So you can go over there. We post each and every week asking for your questions, your topics, and you put them there. And this is where we're getting them from. Okay.
Yeah.
So, Derek Daniel asks, thoughts on Battlefront 2 pulling a Titanfall 2 and adding a story for this installment, and the fact that it'll be covering multiple eras, including The Force Awakens and Rogue One.
Love it.
That it needed to be in the first one.
Yep. It needed to happen.
I think a lot of it was the industry was going in this direction of, oh, multiplayer is where everything's at. That's where most people spend their time, and that's, you saw Evolve do it, then you saw Titanfall do it, and you saw all of these other products, and then you saw them die really, really quickly.
Yeah.
And then they're like, oh, the only one that's doing well that's done that has been Overwatch. Battleborn died. You know, there's several of them that did, you know, Battlefront, I think, did well because it was Star Wars.
Yeah, it helps a lot.
I think that was why it did well for a while. Overwatch, being a Blizzard product, does really well because there's so many people that love Blizzard, and it's a good game.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I hate saying it, but it is a good game. Okay, so them actually adding in that element is what everyone was griping and complaining about before they even launched the game, that we needed this. I hope there's a conquest mode. I hope there's a story mode. I hope that you get to see all these iconic moments again with all those amazing graphics, because Battlefront was probably one of the best looking games that I've seen in a very long time.
Mm-hmm.
Like through and through, like character models, everything, environments, still a beautiful game. 2 years old, I want to say.
And that's one thing. I'm excited that they're having the story, but I would also like to see the Galactic Conquest, like you were talking about, where we can go to the planets and everything, and you know, you and your friends having a battle. I know you can't do much more of like on the LAN parties now, but you know, you can open it up to like an online multiplayer.
Yeah.
Because that's one another thing that everybody was really, really wanting. Because I know me and Brett used to play that all the time when we'd go over to his house and stuff like that. And that was one of the more fun times I've had playing Battlefront was.
You could even do it like how For Honor is doing right now. You could break up into different factions.
Yeah.
And, you know, you could have, like, the people that want to play the prequels, whatever. Or you could have it in a season where half the time you're playing as the prequel factions.
And then switch over.
Switch over to that. And then you could even have the Resistance and the First Order, you know. So you could have three different things that you could do. And then each season or whatever, I'm borrowing for Honor, like you're taking over territories and like you're fighting and you're trying to do that. That would be pretty interesting.
Yeah.
And that could be a multiplayer aspect. And then you could also have it where, like, if I wanted to take over the galaxy, then I pick whatever faction, whatever timeline I want to play in, and then I just go through it the whole time. What would be very interesting is, since they're doing the timelines, what would be cool as a game mode is to mix the timelines.
Yeah.
Like, have the Stormtroopers versus the Clone Troopers, or have the, you know, the Rebels versus the,
Separatists?
The Separatists. I was going to say CIS or whatever their moniker was. But, yeah, the Separatists. Like, you know, it'd be interesting to see, like, it cross.
Yeah.
So I would like to see that. What are your thoughts, Derek?
I mean, I agree with all of that. I think a story mode is necessary. Mm-hmm. It was the major thing that was missing from the first one. I would be very interested if they did maybe like some what-if stories. Because they did this in the comic series. I think it was called like Star Wars Infinity or something like that, where they would take one detail and change it. So say there's a cutscene where Luke shoots the proton torpedo, but it doesn't destroy the Death Star. What happens after that? Something happens and Empire Strikes Back. How do the Rebels react to it? I think doing something like that, you can expand on much more than just one central story.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that would be really cool. They have a lot to work with. This is a franchise that has a ton of lore, so it would be really awesome to see. Derek also asked, thoughts and rumors that there may be another Batman Arkham game. IGN France posted a save the date, and it had March 8th and the WB logo in the same color palette as the Arkham Origins logo. It'll obviously be developed by Warner Brothers Montreal, the people who made Origins, but the rumor, the longest time, that it'll be involved Damian Wayne. We have a month to find out, but I just want your initial thoughts.
As in son of Batman, Damian Wayne?
No. That's his daughter.
I always get those two mixed up.
Yeah.
That would be very interesting, because we haven't really had a game where you play as Damian, have we?
No. It'd be interesting. That would mean if it is a prequel before Arkham City, that Talia al Ghul is not dead.
Yeah.
Because she gets killed in Arkham City. If you didn't play it, then you're just screwed, okay? No, she died, okay? There you go.
Why not this? Why not do a Batman Beyond game?
Oh, that'd be awesome. They did have a skin for... That's not Batman Beyond. That's
for animated. Terry's Batsuit.
Animated what? Series.
Why did I go to animate?
Yeah, they had a skin.
Oh, that's cool.
Knight for him. It was pretty cool.
And why not?
I think it would be awesome. Different timeline. Be able to use the villains that were in that show. Mm-hmm. I think it'd be awesome.
Yeah.
But if they do the Damian Wayne thing, I think it'd be cool. You know, is he going to be Batman? You know, is it going to be like a future thing? You know, I would love to see Dick be Batman, you know, see him take up the mantle and do, the gas. No. What was it? The Gates of Gotham.
That'd be a really cool
storyline to see. So, I can't wait to see it. I hope it is another game. Maybe, you know, a Justice League game.
That would be sweet.
Yeah.
Moving on, Derek also says there's also supposed leaks of Far Cry 5 floating around, according to the news source via European GameStop, showing up for a reserve their computer, regardless of how true this might be, and Ubisoft saying a few months ago that they could go through 2017 without releasing a Far Cry or an Assassin's Creed game. Where would you like Far Cry 5 to take place as the last three games have been set in the Stone Age, Himalayas, and tropical islands of New Guinea? So where would y'all want it to be placed? And do you... Yeah.
I'll be honest. I don't care about Far Cry.
I know nothing about the series or anything, so...
Space. I'm not going to be in space.
Yeah, I mean...
It went Stone Age. Let's take it to space.
Well, everything's better in space.
You know, Blood Dragon was really, really cool. It was the DLC for Far Cry 3. Like this 80s, like 80s action movie. I thought that was an awesome piece of DLC. So if they did something that was along the lines of that, was it 3? Awesome, I got it right. So, see, I got fact checker over there. So this is like the presidential debate. So I would like something along that lines. You know, it doesn't necessarily have to be all serious and all of that. And that's not necessarily Far Cry. Do something cool. Do something fun, you know. And if it's not Far Cry 5, if it's like Far Cry Primal, but it's like Far Cry Deep Space, you know.
Spies.
It's just Tim Curry. Just spies. It'd be interesting. I doubt that Far Cry 5 will come out this year.
Yeah.
That's just my opinion.
It looks like a cool game.
They have For Honor. They have Ghost Recon Wetlands.
They have enough.
In 2 months.
Yeah.
In 2 months. Like February 14th. Ubisoft is For Honor.
A little time to relax after this.
And two betas are going on at the same time. I don't know what you're doing over there, Ubisoft, but you need better planning.
But I like it. I mean.
And it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous.
As long as they're doing it right.
Give me a review copy, please. That's all I'm saying.
Your mom calling you?
Yeah, my mother's calling me.
Anytime he gets a call on the podcast, we know it's Mara Teresa.
I'll call her back in a minute. We're almost done here. Nick asks, what's your favorite Super Bowl foods? Since the Super Bowl is tonight.
Mm-hmm. Is it?
No.
Buffalo chicken dip.
I actually agree with you.
Buffalo chicken dip.
We agree?
Yeah.
Oh, Derek.
Oh,
shucks. But with our inability to break down the lactose and the stuff, it's I live by the buffalo chicken dip and I die by the buffalo chicken dip. So I will be living in about an hour, but about three I will be dying.
Food.
Hot chips, dogs.
You know,
chips.
Gotta have chips.
Yeah.
French onion dip. Good French onion dip. Not like the cheap.
No, the Frisco's cheap.
You know, the cheap stuff. Like, you gotta have good French onion dip.
So, best choice?
No. I'm a hamburger. You know, I'm a simple
He's
man.
He's American.
I'm a man of simple needs. I'm not picky on that kind of stuff. And plus, I don't get invited to Super Bowl parties, so. hit, fools! It's okay. I'm not going to watch a Super Bowl anyway. Nick also asks, any Super Bowl traditions? Not watching them.
I mean, I'm usually, you know, year smoke in a bowl year, or two. I love to smoke a bowl. Yeah, I get me some of that nice.
I'm gonna take that clip. Blackmail. Blackmail.
Last that all through Central High School.
Oh yeah, Mr. Rawls, we need to talk.
This is an intervention.
No, I really don't have any set traditions, because I'm usually, you know. It changes yearly where I go to watch the Super Bowl. You know, there's been times that I've watched it at house. There was a year when I purchased, NFL Mobile, and I watched it when I was in college working at McDonald's. Like, I put it on top of the tray, making people sandwiches, and I had people behind me. We were all watching the Super Bowl in the kitchen. So, you know, no real tradition, but I know we used to, probably when we'd go over to the Sassers or anywhere, we'd always throw the football. So I guess that's the closest thing to a tradition.
Yeah. The past couple of years, I've watched the Super Bowl with, you know, the same like core group of friends, but it's always been a different location. And, you know, we're doing the same thing this year. So
Here's my question. I didn't put it in the comments or anything.
Oh, that's blasphemy.
Why in the world are people putting out Super Bowl commercials before the Super Bowl? That's what gets me.
Yeah.
Like, the whole point of the Super Bowl is these awesome commercials, but we're getting them, like, weeks in advance.
I know the Transformers one got leaked, so they decided to just officially release that one. So that one I get.
But yeah.
Yeah, I'm seeing more and more on Facebook today, oh, watch this Super Bowl commercial.
I think it's dumb because that ruins. That's like if we saw half of Lady Gaga's halftime performance. I mean, it ruins, you know, some things that people enjoy during the Super Bowl. I enjoy the entire thing as a whole. Enjoy the game. I enjoy laughing at the commercials like Puppy Monkey Baby. I'm glad I didn't see that puppy early because I died of laughter when I saw the little Puppy Monkey Baby.
Puppy Monkey Baby.
I hate that they're doing it. They need to kind of chill with it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think, like, when we were growing up, that was one of the best parts of the Super Bowl. Oh, yeah. And then when you go to work the next day or school the next day, that was the topic of discussion was the Super Bowl commercials.
All day.
Yeah. And if you miss one of them because you went to the bathroom, then you're SOL.
Yep.
You know? So I find it ridiculous. Yeah. You know, it just kind of takes away one piece of what makes the Super Bowl the Super Bowl.
I agree.
You know.
Yeah.
But that's from a consumer point of view, not the people that are actually marketing. So they're wanting to get out as many in front of many people as they can.
True.
And then the last question comes from Nick Caputo. What is your ideal day off? Like, what do you do on your ideal day off?
Sleeping in is key.
I agree. Usually I'm up. I have to be up for a school by 5 o'clock. So sleeping in till about 8 o'clock feels like a major accomplishment.
I'm in the same boat as you.
And I feel like such an old man because my body does not let me sleep past that.
Mm-hmm.
That and just having a day where I can go hang out with a friend, maybe go get something to eat. And then just chill.
Sit in La Hacienda for 6 hours.
6 hours, and then get up and realize you can't walk and your bladder's so full and you just pee for like 5 minutes straight. That's still my longest time I've ever spent in a restaurant.
Same here.
But, you know, being able to play games, just relax.
Yeah. Yep.
Sleeping in, watching Netflix, and pizza delivery.
Mine kind of depends on why I'm not at work, because I have work every day, seems like, you know. Sleeping in some is always awesome. When I have extended days off, like, you know, weeks or whatever, I tend not to sleep in as much as I would if it was a singular day. Try to play as much video games. Like, there was one day during, we finished the last competition, I took the next Monday off and played through the rest of Uncharted. That was my plan for that day. I was like, I'm gonna just stay home and play through Uncharted and then go back next day. And, you know, of course, getting something good to eat.
You're right.
You know, mm-hmm. And then it kind of depends on what needs to be done with all of this. You know, if I need to create a video or whatever. So it really depends on what is going on around everything. But
yeah,
that's about it. So there you have it.
Episode 196.
In the books. Guys, if you want it early, if you're listening to it now, you're probably a little late. It's probably Thursday at this point, unless you are over at patreon.com/nerdcave, where you can get everything early there. Starts with one simple dollar.
One simple dollar.
Not a complicated one. A simple one.
Yep. Guys, you can also go over to youtube.com/nerdcavenetwork, and day by day, topic by topic, you can get your awesome Nerdcave podcasts fixed. Fixed. Yeah, like Robin.
We're not broken.
Robin his bowl over there. Day by day, we break it up topic by topic for free over there and facebook.com/nerdcavenetwork. And Friday, it comes out for everybody else that didn't want to pay. That's okay. We understand.
Not really.
You can get it over there, youtube.com/nerdcavenetwork, or podcast services around.
Yeah. We have all kinds of different podcasts that we put out throughout the week.
Derek, just like we're going to finish this up.
Yeah. No, every Monday we have Nerd Cave Retro, where we discuss retro gaming. Tuesday is my solo show, The Derek Diamond Experience. On Wednesdays, during football season, we have Fantasy Football for Nerds with myself and Robbie.
Sprinkled throughout the offseason.
Yeah, sprinkled throughout the offseason. Thursday, we have our wrestling podcast, Battle of the Brands. Friday is this show, the Nerd Cave Podcast. And on Saturdays, we have our friends over at the Pop Culture Palette. And all those shows are available on all podcasting platforms.
Do I say anything?
Social media.
Social media. Guys, we are all over social media, whether it be Twitter, Instagram, and of course, the biggest one, Facebook. We have great Facebook groups where our group, not plural, one group, where we have tons and tons of great interaction with, you know, you guys, and it's so much fun. Mm-hmm. Just search for Nerd Cave, and we're there. And we're Nerd Cave Vids on Instagram, and then Nerd Cave Vids on Twitter as well.
Yep. Each week, guys, I'm pretty much setting up my streaming times now. Everything's kind of calming down. Tuesdays and Thursdays, I'm going to start streaming about 8 o'clock. We're doing Resident Evil right now. The next game up is going to be Horizon Zero Dawn.
The only reason I want to get a PlayStation.
Yep. So,
are you about to say the closing line?
Or? No. Okay. I've been enjoying hanging out with everybody on the live streams. Yeah. It makes Resident Evil so much more fun and slightly less scary.
Okay. Slightly. I've seen you jump quite a few times.
It's not scary. It's just very slightly not scary. As scary. So.
But yep. In the immortal words of Forrest Gump, I gotta go pay.
All right, guys. Thanks for watching. This has been Zach,
Derek,
and Robbie.
Have a week.